Well, today my conversation is with Anita Silvey. She is the author of Unforgotten, The Wild Life of Dian Fossey and Her Relentless Quest to Save Mountain Gorillas. Thank you so much for talking with me here today.
Oh, I love talking about this book. It's
well, I can't wait to hear more. So you wrote this book primarily for kids. Tell me why you did that.
Oh, well, I've been working on books for kids for over 50 years. So I found that profession in 1970 and I fell in love with it. And I just think there's nobody better to communicate to give kids books of quality content, because it can change their lives in incredible ways. And I mean, I love children's books. I love children's books as a child. I love children's books now. I'm as enthusiastic 50 years into my career as I was when I began it. I thought it'd be a lot of fun to create books for children, and it is. It's a lot of fun. So, and I just think that there's a point. I write for kids. My ideal audience is like fifth, sixth, seventh, eighth grade, good fourth grade readers, because at that time, they're beginning to think about what they might do with their lives. Yeah. And they're also, it's a time where they have a great sense of social, they're developing a social conscience. They're developing a conscience about themselves that's outside of themselves, their own life. And that idea that you could devote yourself to a cause and love that cause and stay with that cause is very appealing to young readers at that point. So it's a great time to write about something they might never have thought about, which is, gee, if I love animals, maybe there's something other than being a vet. Maybe I could go and research animals. Maybe I could go do animal census. Maybe I could go be part of the ecology movement and save animals, you know, around the world or in America.
Maybe for somebody who doesn't know who Dian Fossey is, to talk a little bit about her.
Okay, well, Dian Fossey didn't train as a scientist. She was an occupational therapist in Louisville, Kentucky, and she took out a loan and traded in all her life savings for a 7-week trip to Africa. And she got to see all that. She loved animals. She loved animals from the time she was a child, but her parents would only let her have a goldfish. So she never got to have enough pets. So as an adult, her house, she had every pet she could possibly have. She lived on a farm. She had, you know, farm animals, pets. And she saw all these great African animals. And at the end of the trip, they went up in the mountains of DRC near Rwanda. And she saw mountain gorillas for the first time. Wow. And basically she fell in love, Kim. She just fell in love, like right there, right? You know, it's the same way if you see the guy across the crowded room and he's the one, okay? It was that feeling, you know? She's got to get back to these gorillas. I mean, she becomes obsessed with them. And there's a wonderful statement where she said, you know, basically, God, I know these must be my kin, you know, that she felt that they were her family. She felt connected. And so she goes back and she starts to create newspaper articles. And, you know, and then a minor miracle happened, because Lewis Leakey, who had sent Jane Goodall to study chimpanzees in Tanzania, he was giving a lecture and she heard the lecture. She came up to him, she gave him the newspaper articles, and he said, let's talk over breakfast the next day. And she was 32 years old. She had no scientific training. She said, I might be too old. I don't know enough. He said, oh no. He said, that's not a problem. He said, I don't like people who have too much science in their mind. You know, yeah. I need somebody who's going to go out and tell me what they see, not what they think they're going to see. And he thought women were the best researchers, for that's why he wanted women in the field. Of course, there weren't a lot of women in the field, but that's why he wanted them there. And he raised the money from National Geographic to send her to. She eventually gets in Rwanda and she sets up camp there for, it's going to be for 18 years that she will research mountain gorillas. So she goes out every morning. I mean, at first she has to acclimate herself to them because they, you know, they're a little shy of human beings and, you know, there are poachers in the area and, you know, and so she mimics their behavior. She walks on her knuckles. She scratches herself. She learns to belch. They belch a lot. They eat a lot of food. They belch. So she learns to belch. She learns to sing like gorillas. And eventually they really take her into their families and she begins to make observations that no one has ever made before with these animals.
What an amazing life. And And, you know, sadly, she was murdered as well, right?
She gave everything. Yeah, she gave her life for this.
What do you think would do that?
Well, there are a lot of theories. They came out and they contaminated the crime scene. I mean, they would have had the evidence, but they moved everything around. She was in her own cabin. You know, I mean, this day and age, they would find fingerprints and DNA and, yeah, you know, they would have solved the crime, but they didn't have that sophisticated of techniques. And it is believed that it might have been people in the government because, right, she, or hired by people, yeah, in the government, because she was stirring things up there and she really wanted to, you know, get rid of poachers and to get people off the land who were taking over the guerrillas' territory. I mean, she was very vigilant in her activities. And she had evidently, you know, she had rubbed enough people the wrong way that when they found out she was coming back for good, she left for a while. She went to Cornell. They thought maybe she was going to stay in the United, yeah, States, you know. But when she came back for good, somebody decided that she had to be removed. So it is really a tragedy. I mean, I had to write a chapter called Tragedy Strikes, yeah, twice, where I talk about the death of the gorilla Digit that she loved and then Diane's death itself. But the fortunate thing was that she had trained enough graduate students. She had enough people working in camp and they stayed in the area and they bought into her drive, you know, that continue. And of course she raised enough money through the Dian Fossey Fund that they still exist there. They still take care of research. You know, it's a thriving operation. She got Sir David Attenborough to set up funds for the gorillas because she brought him out and for the first time he got to hang out with the gorilla family, you know. So she had laid the seeds for the continuing taking care of these animals that she had loved so much.
So Anita, what does a life in the day, you know, or a day in the life of a gorilla look like?
Well, that was the thing that fascinated me. You know, that's something that I knew a little bit about Dian Fossey, but I'd never thought about what does a gorilla do? What does a non-gorilla do? So I actually give kids two pages where we get to see what a gorilla does. Basically, they get up early, they hunt for food. The male gorilla eats about 75 pounds of plants all day. Think about that. I mean, 75 pounds. I mean, you know, I get a salad in at lunch, but you know, I mean, they just eat shoots and leaves. I mean, they eat 75 different, 100 different kinds of leaves, you know, so they're constantly hunting for plants. They're very peaceful. Every now and then they'll eat an ant, but they are, you know, they are herbivores completely. And then they have to rest and eat and digest the food. And, you know, they stay with their family unit. A lot of belching goes on. And the male gorillas and the downtime, they play with the young gorillas. So they'll wrestle with them. They'll tickle them. They put them on their tummies. They have big gorilla stomachs, you know, and the kids bounce on the tummies of the big male gorillas, you know, and then they go out again and hunt for plants again and eat some more again and then sleep again. So it's a, they move around in a particular range and they're always hunting for food. That's hunting for food, eating food, digesting food and playing. And then when it's nice in the day, they play in the sun and then they take a nap. So it's a pretty nice day, actually.
Yeah. Where do they sleep? Where do they sleep when they go to sleep, especially at night?
Well, these gorillas, because they're so large, they really sleep on the ground. Every now and then you see one climbing, but they're a little, 400 pounds is a little too big to get, you know, if you're a male, yeah, gorilla, you just can't get yourself into the tree. Right. So they really sleep in kind of small units together on the ground, but there aren't any animals really in that area that challenge them. So they don't have animal predators. They do have, however, human predators. They have the poachers who come and kill them, you know, for the trophies that they sell at stores. So they have to be careful of human beings, but they can, you know, otherwise they're fine in terms of sleeping on the ground. And then they wake in the morning and they go hunt for more plants. So,
yeah, she was just such an advocate for them. And I look at the pictures, you know, I've seen specials. I look at the pictures in your book here. And I mean, look at those eyes, that face that looks so human-like. Now this book it's part of a trilogy, right?
Right. I wrote books for, I wrote first about Jane Goodall, and then I wrote about Birute Galdikas, who studied the orangutans. And she's still in Borneo, by the way. She never left her research station. She's in her 70s and she lives in her research station in, wow, I know, out in the back. And I mean, it takes hours to get to it from civilization at all. She never left it. If you have that book, if you want to take off the dust jacket, this is the thing I love to show people since you have it right.
This one, doesn't he have a dust
jacket? Oh, it doesn't have a dust jacket. Okay. Well, anyway, on the one that has a dust jacket, there's a big male gorilla underneath the dust jacket. So it really, you're right. That's just a pre-printed binding. But yeah, you know, wonderful pictures of the gorillas. It was fascinating to work on all three women. All personally were very, very different. They had different personalities, but their passion was the same. They fell in love with the species. They gave everything to protecting it. You know, Jane Goodall has of course expanded her role to include all animals. You know, I mean, she's an advocate for ecology, animals. You know, I mean, she is actually the best known scientist in the world because of her continued work, advocating for animal rights. But they all, you know, they all gave everything. They had no cynicism. They never stopped, pneumonia didn't stop them, you know, fevers didn't stop them, broken ankles didn't stop them, whatever went on, they just were so wedded to this cause greater than themselves. And I think that's what ties them all together. They all knew each other.
Yeah.
And on occasion, and when Diane was back in the United States, before she went back to Africa, they traveled together as a group and did lectures together as a group. I so wish I could have been, I would have given anything. I mean, I've heard Jane Goodall lecture many times, but to see the three of them together and to have them talk about the animals that they loved and what they were doing. So they knew each other. They knew what each other was doing in research, and that helped. You know, I mean, they weren't, you know, if you were a woman in science at that time, you were pretty much alone.
Right.
And the good thing is, at least they had a sense of not being alone. That Diane trained with Jane Goodall, you know, Berute trained with Jane Goodall. They were in touch with each other. They often, you know, saw each other. So they knew there were others like them out there in the world.
And she had that relationship with Louis Leakey, who was a paleoanthropologist, an amazing relationship. And she ended up getting closer to gorillas than any other human. Isn't that right?
That's exactly true. I start the book out with one of the most amazing scenes in Diane's life. And it was actually captured on camera because National Geographic had set a photographer there. And she was finding so many things. And so they sent Bob Campbell, one of their best nature photographers, there. And they went out to this group that Diane had been hanging out with. And there was this young male who was just strutting about. She named him Peanuts. He was just a show off. And he was, you know, doing all kinds of things. And so she started to scratch herself, and then Peanuts would scratch himself. And so she puts out her hand, and Peanuts comes over and grabs her hand and holds hands with her. And they captured this on camera. And then he goes off and he struts and, you know, does his adolescent thing. And right. Diane said she wept softly, and because it was the first time she believed that a gorilla had ever held hands with a human being. So, yeah.
How did she come up with the names?
Well, you know, Jane Goodall had started naming animals, and so she knew she was going to do it. And it was just kind of their personality, what they brought to mind. The funny one was she named one of them Uncle Bert because she had an Uncle Bert, and she thought he'd be really happy with her because he had a gorilla named after him. But he was furious. I mean, he never forgave her. You know, he didn't want a gorilla named after him. But the personality of Uncle Bert the gorilla reminded her of her Uncle Bert. So, so she would come up with different names. She had identified, called one of her favorites was called Puck. And she believed Puck to be a male until one day Puck gave birth to a baby gorilla. And Diane's first words were, "It can't be," because she now realizes that Puck is a woman. And they named the gorilla Can't Be. So that came out of her confusion about the sex of the gorillas that she was looking at. I guess it is rather difficult. I've never identified gorillas by sex. So I haven't had to do that. I haven't had to go there.
Right. I mean, your book is just filled with so much information, and the photographs are just amazing. But because of Dian Fossey, there are twice as many gorillas. Why is that important?
Well, they were at the mountain gorillas were when she first surveyed them, and they didn't even know how many there were, but, you know, until she does her first survey, there are only 275 of them. And that is, of course, you're starting to get toward extinction. You know, you're starting to get toward the point where they're not going to breed in the wild, where all the animals are going to be away in institutions breeding there. I mean, Birute Galdikas said to me that, she said, the thing that that has haunted me my entire career is that idea that someday there might be a lone orangutan calling in the wild, and he doesn't know there aren't any other orangutans there, you know? So they're all, for all of them, they were against that, you know, that extinction. And she came up with, you know, ways to fight the poachers. Some of her students started an ecotourism business. They had learned this, you know, from others. And what they were finding is that people came in, people like, if Ellen DeGeneres comes in and she sees a gorilla, you are more likely to love it. You know, you're more likely to want to do something for it. Right. So they began to set up limited ecotourism so that people could really value. They began to bring those in the community into working, tracking, and doing those things, which, of course, you know, I mean, almost all of the trackers of the Fossey Foundation are now from the local community. And in that way, making people value what was there and laying the groundwork for increasing the gorilla population. It's well over 600 now. It's growing every year. And her students who stayed on are, many of them, largely responsible because they never gave up the quest that she trained them in.
How wonderful. How wonderful she was able to plant those seeds before her life was taken. In researching her, because I've only got you for a couple more minutes, in researching her, what were some of the biggest surprises?
Well, one of the biggest surprises, well, one, there are two. She loved high fashion clothes, Parisian clothes, and big jewelry. Now, I wouldn't expect that from somebody in the bush, you know. It's not. And when she got into civilization, she dressed. I mean, she dressed to the nines. And then she'd go to big dinner parties and, you know, entertain people. So I was surprised by that little quirk. But what amazed me is she kept, not only did she research the gorillas, she kept pets, all kinds of pets, in the camp itself. So she has a boxer dog. She has a blue monkey who's creating havoc. Her first pets were Lucy and Desi, a rooster and chicken. They lay fresh eggs, you know. She has all kinds of birds. She has she comes back to this menagerie, and then the antelope would come in and play with the pets in the, you know, the real pets. So she'd have wild animals, the pets running around the camp all night, and she was perfectly happy. She was never away from animals. I might have left off a monkey or two myself. You know, he was a terror. So
you know. It's funny, it's talking about high fashion, you know, it'd be funny to see the gorillas, what they would think if she showed up to camp looking like that.
Oh, yeah. Well, you know, they would play with her things. They'd get a hold of her binoculars. They'd take her journal. Wow. If she had candy bars, they'd rip the candy. I mean, anything she brought to them, they were going to examine and make their own. So, yeah, I don't think she should have shown up in her designer clothes. Who knows what they would have wanted from that jewelry, you know? So
they'd have way too much fun. You know, yeah. I read this quote in the book, only the very best of anything can be good enough for the young. That she believed that, right?
Yeah, well, you that believe is my, that. That she believed that. That is my quote, however. That's me talking about, that's what I believe about children's books, that only the very best in anything can be good enough for the young. And, you know, that's why we need books that have content, that make kids think, that make them realize there are possibilities. And I just want them to be inspired by lives of Jane Goodall, Birute, Diane, you know, because they're such fabulous women and they made so much difference because of what they loved.
Yes. Thank you so much for telling that story. It's Anita Silvey, author of Unforgotten, The Wildlife of Dian Fossey and Her Relentless Quest to Save Mountain Gorillas. Where can people reach out to you?
Anita Silvey, SILVEY.com, or I am at Anita Silvey at Twitter if anyone wants to send me a note.
This is a great book. Every little kid needs to get their hands on that. Get some more advocates out there for the animals. Yeah. So thank you for talking with me today. It's been so much fun.
Thank you so much, Kim. Nice to see you.
Nice to see you.